me if I'm sentimental when we say goodbye? Don't be angry with me, should I cry?
Hello there, and welcome to the 36th annual Elvis is Back in the Building birthday bash. My name is Marty Barrett, and I'm delighted to be your host tonight for this celebration of the King's 87th. This is the longest running Elvis's birthday tribute show in the world. It started right here in Los Angeles. Well, in Pasadena, but we sometimes incorporate Pasadena when it is convenient to us. I'll tell you a little bit about it. The year was 1986. You could buy an automobile for a stick of gum, but changes were afoot. David Lee Roth had left Van Halen, Sammy Hagar had joined, and James Intveld, musician, guitar player, patriot, started the very first Elvis's birthday bash in a little club in Pasadena on January 8th, 1986. The show was so popular that the next year, it moved over the hill into Hollywood to Club Lingerie, now closed, and later it went to the House of Blues, now closed. Later it went to the Palace on Cahuenga, now closed. Spent a little bit of time at the Music Box at the Henry Fonda Theater. Then it made a journey over the Hollywood Hills into the Valley, where for several years it was at the Palomino Club. Then it hit hard times, and there was one of those years where it was at a bowling alley. I am not kidding you. And finally, when I got to see it, it was at Joe's American Bar and Grill, a great place on Magnolia in Burbank, which COVID has also closed. Just very, very sad when you see what this pandemic has done to some great institutions in Los Angeles. But speaking of institutions, the host from 1987 onward was a man named Art Fine, who was a rockabilly impresario and a cable access star. And he helped book the bands, he emceed the show, he was the show pretty much, and he brought in a lot of celebrities and raised the awareness of Elvis Presley in particular, but the rockabilly scene in Los Angeles in general for people all over the country. And there were national acts that would come and play at the Elvis show. When Art retired in December of 2019, I got a call to suggest that I take it over. And 3 weeks later, in the 35th show, I took it to Joe's, and it was a rockin' night. And we had big plans for the 2021 show. And then something sidelined us for about 20 months or so. And we thought we would come back for a triumphant return in 2022, but the COVID numbers are higher this January than they even were last January when everything was closed. So we decided we would rather have different Zoom rooms in the Heartbreak Hotel than have all our wonderful fans on a ventilator. Now, tonight's show is not going to be a four-hour affair like a lot of the Elvis's birthday shows. It's going to be stripped down, and in the little bit more than an hour, you'll hear a bunch of great songs, meet some wonderful people who are not only veterans, but there's some newcomers as well. And you'll also meet Ronnie Mack, who has been with this show since 1987. And you know, you'll learn something along the way. So, our first act, two kids who met each other at the USC Thornton School of Music in 2016. They call themselves the Prickly Pear, and they are comprised of Mason Summit and Irene Green. You can find them on all social platforms at the Prickly Pear Music. They will have their first single coming out late next month. Please say hello to the Prickly Pear.
trap. I can't walk out because I love you too much, baby.
Why can't you see what you're doing to me when you don't believe what I'm saying? We can't go on together. I'd say hello. Would I still see suspicion in your eyes? Here we go again. You ask me where I've been. You can't see the tears are real, I'm crying. Can't go on together with suspicious minds, and we can't build our dreams on suspicious minds. All that I love survive. I'll dry.
St. Louis, Deke Dickerson is a sought-after guitarist and writer for Guitar Player magazine and Vintage Guitar magazine. He is also the proud owner of an amp that was once owned by Elvis's guitarist, Scotty Moore. I hope it is not a haunted amp. Here is Deke Dickerson.
Okay, a fool such as I. Here we go. Now and then, there's a fool such as I. Pardon me if I'm sentimental when we say goodbye. Don't be angry with me should I cry. Since you're gone, yet I'll dream a little. Dream as years go by. Now and then there's a fool such as I. And now and then there's a fool such as I am. Over you, you taught me how to love, and now you say that we are through. I'm a fool, but I love you, dear, until the day I die. Knowing that there's a fool such as I. Now and then, there's a fool such as I. Now and then, there's a fool such as I am. Over you, you taught me how to love, and now you say that we are through. I'm a fool, but I love you, dear, until the day I die. Now and then, there's a fool such as I. Now and then, there's a fool such as I. Now and then, there's a fool such as I.
Tense. You're a young man. You need to relax. Learn to take some joy in your work. Do you like music? That's better.
My home in Norfolk, Virginia, California, home by mine. I straddle that Greyhound and rode him in the Raleigh and all across Carolina. Somebody help me get out of the middle. People there care a little about me. They wouldn't let the poor boy down.
All right.
I'm proud to introduce our next guest, who is rockabilly royalty. For the past 45 years, Ronnie Mack has been a fixture, not only the rockabilly scene, but a number of different coalescing LA music scenes where everybody knows him and he knows everybody. It's difficult to get a word in edgewise with Ronnie, but you don't really care to, because he has so many interesting stories to tell. He has been with the Elvis's birthday bash on and off since 1987, and for years hosted the very popular Ronnie Mack's Barn Dance. I think you're gonna like this guy if you don't know him already, Ronnie Mack.
There's always a lot of people that love that kind of music, but were afraid to admit it. That's the way I kind of was, you know, in our age, because we grew up during the hippie years and stuff like that. And the 50s rock and roll, that type of music just kind of laughed at, looked as a joke kind of thing, if you were into that kind of thing back in those days. So James Infeld once said something to me when we were driving his 1951 green pickup truck down at Garden Grove, where he lived with his parents, back in about 1990. And we were talking about where he's going and what he's doing, and rockabilly and country. And he said, we're hip because we're square. And I brought that up to him years later. He didn't remember saying it, but I've always remembered it. Meaning that there's this whole community of people that's a cult, musical cult, rockabilly. But you add them up all over the United States, all over the world, it's probably into the millions. So what he means is we're hip with all of those other square people because we're square. Because you're not supposed to, it's not hip to be into rockabilly, you know, back in those days at all. So I've always remembered that. And I think that people came out of the woodwork when it was neat to know, and I, for myself, to know that, wow, all these other people think like me. I was laughed at for going to doing coffee houses in 1969, 1970, I was 15, 16 years old. At the height of the Woodstock era, and you got all these like 22, 23, 24, 28 year old college people or something doing protest songs, you know, and doing songs and doing anti-war songs. And you get three songs, and I'm up there in this coffee house gigs doing blue suede shoes, whole lot of shaking going on, and the twist. And I don't remember people laughing too hard at me. You know? I could try to be polite. But that was me going back that far. You know, I looked at music. And I just, you know, it was nothing like what they were doing. But that's why when this whole scene started, wow, this is really cool. And I can get involved in that, you know.
Hi, folks. The song I chose to do for the Elvis birthday tribute is a song that goes back to the 1940s. The first actual recording of it was done by one of the kings of the singing cowboys, Gene Autry. He recorded it in 1945. It went on to be recorded by even jazz and pop stars like Bing Crosby and the Andrews Sisters, and of course country stars such as Gentleman Jim Reeves and Eddie Arnold. But the first artist of the rock era to record it was Elvis, and he recorded it in January of 1957, almost before my time. And it went on to be on an album called Loving You. Other rockers that era, after hearing Elvis's version, recorded great versions of it also. Rick Nelson, Eddie Cochran also did it. And it's become an all-time classic in different genres of music. And I'd like to do it for you right now. It's called Have I Told You Lately That I Love You? Have I told you lately that I love you? Could I tell you once again somehow? And have I told with all my heart and soul how I adore you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now. Have I told you lately when I'm sleeping? Every dream I dream is you somehow. And have I told you why the nights are long when you're not with me? Well, darling, I'm telling you now. My heart would break into if I should lose you. But I'm no good without you anyhow. Have I told you lately that I love you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now. My heart would break in two if I should lose you. I'm no good without you anyhow. And have I told you lately that I love you? Well, darling, I'm telling you now. Well, darling, I'm telling you.
Day, Alias Means is an earnest gentleman crooner, and this is his 10th appearance with the Elvis's birthday bash. Alias remembers that one night at the Echoplex, he got the spirit in him and emphasized a band stop with an Elvis-style karate kick. Art Fine came up to him a little bit later and he said, "This is a night of tributes, not impersonations. Keep the karate kicks to yourself." Doing a Jerry Reed song that Elvis made popular, here's Alias Means.
This is called Trying to Get to You. Happy birthday, King. Well, I've been traveling over mountain, even through the valleys too. I've been traveling night and day. I've been running all the way, baby, trying to get to you. Ever since I read your letter, where you said you loved me true. Well, I've been traveling night and day. I've been running all the way, baby, trying to get to you. When I read your loving letter,
coming through. I kept traveling night and day, I kept running all the way, baby, trying to get to you. What I do, I would travel night and day, I would still run all the way, baby, trying to get to you. Well, there's nothing that could hold me or keep me away from you. When your loving letter told me that you really love me true. The Lord above me knows I love you. It was He who brought me through. When my way was dark as night, He would shine His brightest light when I was trying to get to you.
Thanks very much. Happy birthday, Elvis, and happy 2022 to everybody else.
Dylan Thomas is a virtuoso guitar player who is one of those guys who plays with every band in town. But his main gig is with the band 45 Grave. He is a biker and a devoted and loving cat owner. Playing the very David Lynchian Cotton Candyland, here is Dylan Thomas.
Sandman's coming, yes, he's coming to sprinkle you with sand. He'll say one, two, three, then you will be in Cotton Candy Land. Sandman's coming, yes, he's coming, take him by the hand.
In addition to this show itself being a tradition, there are many traditions that are observed within the show. So for example, when I started hosting, I became aware that things have been done a certain way since the very beginning, and I wasn't going to mess with it. For example, a lot of people want to be in the show, and there's a couple of rules to determine who gets to do it. Also, there is a fantastic house band which for many years consisted of a rhythm section of David Raven on drums, Paul Marshall on bass. Marty Rifkin played steel guitar, Skip Edwards played keyboards, and Harry Orlove played guitar and was the band leader. Unfortunately for California, Harry Orlove moved back to Baltimore over the pandemic. So we were very lucky to be able to turn to John Groover McDuffie, who has played guitar for just about everybody. And it makes me sad that John didn't get a chance to lead the Elvis's Birthday Bash band this year when I very callously pulled the plug on a live show a few days ago. But John McDuffie is here with Hunk of Burning Love.
Lord Almighty, I feel my temperature rising. Higher and higher, it's burning through to my soul. Girl, 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 you're gonna set me on fire. My brain is flaming, I don't know which way to go. Because your kisses lift me high, like the sweet song of a choir. You light the morning sky with your burning love. Ooh, I feel my temperature rising. Help me, I'm flaming, I must be 109. Burning, 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 and nothing can cool me. I just might turn into smoke, but I feel fine. Because your kisses lift me high, like the sweet song of a choir. You light the morning sky with your burning love. It's coming closer, the flames are now licking my body. Lord, won't you help me? I feel like I'm slipping away. It's hard to breathe, and my chest is a-heaving. Lord, have mercy, I'm burning a hole where I lay. Because your kisses lift me high, like a sweet tone of a choir. You light my morning sky with your burning love. I got a hunk of burning love. I got a hunk of burning love. I got a hunk of burning love, y'all. I got a hunk of burning love. I got a burning love. I got a burning love. I got a hunk of I got a hunk of chocolate cake and a burning love. Burning love. I burning love, y'all. Burning love, burning love, baby, burning love, you're burning me up.
This is Justin Curtis's 20th Elvis's Birthday Bash. His first show was in 2001 at the House of Blues. An interesting thing about Justin was that one day he was moseying on his ranch and chanced to look up, and he saw some ghost riders in the sky. And then the lead ghost rider looked down at Justin and he said, "You know what, man? You're living right. You're not gonna have to deal with the devil's herd." True story. Anyway, Justin Curtis.
Well, 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 just because you think you're so pretty, and just because your mama thinks you're hot, just because you think you got something that nobody else has got, it caused me to spend all my money. You laugh and call me old Santa Claus. Well, baby, I'm through with you. Because, just because.
Deke Dickerson returns with Gray DeLIsle, who is a quintuple threat. I'm going to try to add those up anyway. Not only does she have four auto harps that are named for members of the Carter family, but Gray is a sought-after voiceover artist, having provided the voice for Daphne in Scooby-Doo for the last 20 years, Martin in The Simpsons, and has provided the voice for Azula in Avatar: The Last Airbender, among many, many others. She's also released a handful of albums that are at turns poignant, ethereal, and growly rockabilly and country music. And she is singing a song that was made famous by Willie Nelson with Deke. And I don't know what their combined term is, so we're just calling it Greek.
All right, always on my mind. Are you ready to do this, Gray?
I sure am, Deke.
Okay, let's try it.
Maybe I didn't treat you quite as good as I should have. Maybe I didn't love you quite as often as I could. Little things I should have said and done, I just never took the time. You were always on my mind.
You were always on my mind.
You were always on my mind.
Maybe I didn't hold you all those lonely, lonely times, and I guess I never told you I'm so happy that you're mine. I make you feel second best. Girl, I'm sorry I was blind. You were always on my mind. You were always on my mind. should have said and done. I just never took the time.
You were always on my mind. You were always on my mind.
You were always on my mind.
Boy, Groovelator Studios. I've really made it.
Hey, who is it?
It's the man.
The man with the power?
Yes.
Marty, hi.
Hey, how you doing? Hey,
good,
John.
How are you?
I was coming into Los Angeles today, and I saw a sign that said, "Welcome to Los Angeles, guitar by John McDuffie."
Huh.
So I thought I'd come down.
I forgot I even did that.
Do you know anything in C that we might be able to do?
Probably. C is one of my 12 favorite keys.
All right, let's go in.
Okay, great.
Boy, this is where the magic happens.
I just happen to have a guitar right here.
Well, before the guitar, I guess we're going to have to check vaccinations.
Oh, yeah, good point.
First things first.
Okay, here's mine.
And here's mine.
Okay, good. I guess we're okay. No alarms going off?
Yeah, do you feel sick or...
No, I'm feeling fine.
Okay.
I mean, you know, from the neck down anyway.
So John McDuffie, you've been playing these Elvis shows for a really long time, and they haven't been at the same club often.
No, they moved around quite a bit over the years.
There was the Henry Fonda Music Box, and there was that place up on Cahuenga.
You mean Jack Sugar Shack? Oh, no, you mean the Avalon?
Yep. But I think it was at the Sugar Shack, too.
Yeah.
And it was at a place called Club Lingerie.
Wow, that takes me back.
And is that place even open?
I don't think so. I mean, it's something else now and then. Okay.
And the House of Blues is no longer there?
Right, that's gone.
Now, would you say that the Elvis show effectively closed down these locations? Or did that have anything to do with it?
I don't know if that can be directly attributed, but it's always a chance.
All right. And then it was at Joe's Bar and Grill.
Right.
And that has closed because of
COVID.
Sadly. Well, it kind of makes you nostalgic for the halcyon days of L.A. clubs.
It sure does.
I'm wondering if there's an Elvis song that might convey that feeling of lonesomeness.
You know, there is one. I think I remember.
Oh. I know this song. I'm gonna wait till it comes around on the guitar.
Are you lonesome tonight? Do you miss me tonight? Are you sorry we drifted apart? Does your memory stray to a bright summer day when I kissed you and called you sweetheart? Do the chairs in your parlor seem empty and bare? Do you gaze at your doorstep and picture me there? Is your heart filled with pain? Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome tonight?
Oh, hello. I was wondering if you're lonesome tonight. You know, both Shakespeare and Rush said the world is a stage. We all just play a part. Fate had me playing at love with you as my sweetheart. Act one was when we met. I fell for you at first glance. You read your lines so perfectly and never missed a cue. But then came act two. Things had changed. You started acting strange, and why I'll never know. Honey, you lied when you said you loved me. I had no cause to doubt you. But I'd rather go on believing your lies than to stay here without you. Now the stage is bare, and I'm standing there with emptiness all around. And if you won't come back to me, they can bring the curtain down. Your heart filled with pain. Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome tonight? I'm sorry, John, I've got to go.
All right, Marty. Well, thanks for stopping by.
Having just celebrated her 15th anniversary as curator and host of the Dylan Hours, which is broadcast internationally every Sunday from LA station KCSN, Lisa Finney would dearly love to return to her beloved side hustle as a gigging musician when it's safe to go out. To make the best of a difficult situation, Lisa wrote a lovely lullaby for her daughter called Away From Home for the Holidays this past fall, which has received substantial airplay. Here's Lisa Finney. Lisa!
Marty!
It's 2022, and I don't usually speak in palindromes, and I get tongue-tied around math, but your first Elvis show was 2002 at the House of Blues.
The House of Blues.
And now you're online, which is a step up. How yes. did you first appear on an Elvis birthday bash stage?
Well, after pestering Art Fine and getting him to agree to let us do one song, I knew I wanted it to be something really interesting and fun, because that was my experience as an audience member attending those birthday bashes year after year, was just that shared love of Elvis Presley and also the shared joy and the fun of it. So there would be acts that would come out and sing songs very literally and deliver them in all of their gorgeous, beautiful solemnity. And then there would be also these kind of wacky acts that would come out and make you laugh and dance. And all of that is what makes the bash so magical. So I wanted to have something kind of in between. And so I decided it would be fun to do the song Wooden Heart that was featured in the Elvis Presley film, G.I. Blues. And in it, he is singing and dancing along with marionettes. And he sings half of the song in English and the other half of the song in German. And so I was able to get an old friend who is a piano player and an accordion player, along with a friend of hers who plays the tuba. And then my dear friend, John Palmer, who's a great drummer and percussionist, to come and play a big covered tambourine. And the four of us marched out onto the House of Blues stage and delivered Wooden Heart with, you know, joy and silliness. And we had a great time. It was a blur at the time. I was super nervous. It was a full house and we just had a great time with it, marched out, sang it. I remember people got really excited when I sang the verse in German. And then next thing I knew, go ahead.
How was your German?
It was okay. I at that time in my life, I was teaching English as a second language. And
really?
Yes. And I anytime I've sung in a foreign language, I've always solicited help and criticism from, you know, speakers of the language, you know, native speakers of the language. So I had a student at the time that, you know, let me sing the song and those verses to her a number of times so she could help me with the accent and stuff like that. So
a dirndl was your hair in braids?
Yes, I was wearing in braids and a little kind of old-fashioned dress that, you know, could be mistaken for something from the old country. And we had a great time with it and finished the song and marched off as we were ending the song, and people really responded in a nice way. So that was very exciting. And then that was sort of our way into the Elvis birthday bash, because every year after that, Art Fine was quite welcoming and inviting. And so it's been really an honor and a great pleasure to participate every year.
Now, you haven't told me this yourself, but I have heard that it's kind of difficult over the years to be included in this roster. You know, it started in 1986, and by 2002, it must have been very difficult to get on the bill. And you said that you'd been a fan and you'd been an audience member for this show for years before that. Mm-hmm. So you had to do some pestering yourself.
Oh, absolutely. And keep in mind that through the different kinds of configurations of the Elvis birthday bash, you know, you might see celebrities on the show, and everyone. I remember seeing Bruce Willis perform on it and Woody Harrelson perform on it. And of course, Johnny Rivers for years, a guest artist on it, and just so many wonderful artists, not only celebrities, of course, but also just our wonderful local artists. And of course, the founders of the bash, including, you know, the great Ronnie Mack and great James Infeld and Rosie Flores and Russell Scott, and just so many of these artists, the house band, Fred Willard, may he rest in peace, just so many wonderful figures and fixtures on the bash. And so it can be kind of daunting, of course, you know, especially if you're a huge fan of Elvis Presley, and then of course as well of all of those acts. So, you know, it takes some courage to assert yourself and ask to be included in something like that. And then there was also the criteria where in order to perform on it, you needed to be an artist working in the music community and gigging regularly. And so it was a good goal to have, to sort of be able to meet the criteria and pester, like you say. You know, you don't get if you don't ask. So
right,
you just keep asking.
And so you kept asking. You were a gigging musician.
Yes.
But you're a scrappy kid from Pasadena, and you grew up going to see Van Halen. Where did the Elvis come from in your life, and how did you get involved with this group?
Well, Elvis Presley was my first idol and my first role model. I wanted to be Elvis when I was a little kid, and I wanted to sing like him. I loved him. I adored him. He was my first love and my very first record album that I bought for myself.
Okay, hold on.
Elvis Presley collection.
Where did you buy that album? what was the album, and do you remember how much you paid for it?
It was an album that I bought after watching an advertisement on television, and I ordered it. I picked up the phone and I ordered it COD. And when it was an Elvis Presley collection, it was just like this cheap double collection, cheap RCA reissue thing. And when it was delivered, my mom had to pay for it. And I remember she was not happy about that, but I still have it. I still have it. I mean, it's in there. It's in my record collection over here. It's over there. In there. I mean, it's not playable anymore. It's completely scratched, but I could never throw it away because it was my very first purchase of music of my own.
Yeah. And I wonder how much your mother had to fork over from her purse.
Yeah, I can't remember. I think it was like $4.99 or something. I was probably 7. So this is maybe 1973 or something like that. So whatever a cheap record on the, sold over the television would be at that time. So I don't know, it was probably like $5 or something like that. Maybe 10.
Right. And
he's not happy about it though.
But all the other little kids in the neighborhood are buying, Norman Greenbaum and
Simon and Garfunkel.
Yeah, Lord David Douglas. all right. So you're that kid who loves Elvis and the things that are associated with him. At the same time, you're a California kid listening to K-Rock and, all the different scenes coalescing. When did you meet the Rockabilly road hogs?
That was late 1989. And, there was a club in Pasadena at the corner of California and Fair Oaks called One West. And it was a restaurant with a nightclub. They had a DJ and people went dancing there. And again, you mentioned K-Rock. It was definitely during one of K-Rock's heydays, lots of nightclub dancing. And, but on Monday nights, there was a rockabilly band that featured James Infeld and Ronnie Mack, DJ Bone Break, and others. And on the breaks, the club music director, DJ, would play music from their library, and it was all this K-Rock related music. And so the rockabilly fans were not happy, and they thought, well, we got to get some music in here that they'll dance to. And a friend of mine was a bartender there at the time and knew that I had records like that, and I had been DJing parties and stuff like that. So he said, hey, you want to come DJ down here on Monday nights? You've got your 50s records, you could come do it. And I was like, yeah. So it's one of those groups. I seem to have this talent for stumbling onto DJ gigs.
There have been several newspaper articles about you in local traditional media about your other DJ gig, and just for the sake of posterity, the last time I went to an event where there was a DJ, he was wearing a mouse head, and there was a light show and everything. But when I remember growing up, and you would go, there would be a DJ at a Jack and Jill or a wedding reception or something like that. The person doing the DJ duties had a lot of stuff to carry. What was your rig at that point?
That's so interesting you say that. Well, thankfully the club had the equipment. I just had to bring records. So that was really nice. I've certainly had to bring gear to parties and weddings and doing that. Yeah, I've rented, you know, now I have my own PA system because I've got that when I was gigging for music. But back in the day when I was doing weddings, I would actually have to rent the equipment. And yeah, it was quite something. So for the One West gig, that was already in place. So all I had to do was bring my crate of records and go. So that was.
And your crate was a milk crate, right?
I've certainly have DJed with milk crates. A friend of mine built me a beautiful wooden DJ record crate that I used for that gig, which I also still have because apparently I don't throw anything away.
Well, Lisa, this has been really fun. You've been instrumental in my hosting this show, and you are a treasure to Los Angeles and everybody who knows you.
Oh, Marty, that's so kind. We are just so happy that you've taken it up and are helping us continue the party.
Thank you. You know, after all these years have passed, where does Elvis live in your life right now?
Oh, right here. Always right here. I don't know if you can see that here. I'm patting my... Yes. I'll never leave Elvis.
I'm going to do an Elvis Presley song I've loved since I was a little girl, dreaming of becoming a singer and wanting so badly to sing like Elvis Presley. I've never done this song on an Elvis birthday bash before, I think, because it's so close to my heart and it's such a quiet, beautiful little piece. I thought it might get lost in the party. So I thank you so much for having me, Marty. This song was written by Liebren Stoller, and it was a number one hit for Elvis Presley in 1958. Here we go.
Don't, that's what you say each time that I
stay.
happy birthday to the king.
Our friend Carol McArthur is a multi-instrumentalist and a musical sponge. To hear her speak, you would never know that she's an avid horror fan. To hear her sing, you would never know that she's a super fan of the prog rock band King Crimson. But instead, tonight, she is singing a song that reflects Elvis Presley's devotional side. And it's a good song to end our program with, because sends us off into some dark days ahead with a little bit of hope. So here's Carol McArthur, and please stay till the end for some very special thank yous.
This is a song that many, many people have covered, including Mahalia Jackson for Martin Luther King's funeral, Aretha Franklin, and of course Elvis. It's a song that's precious to me, precious to a lot of people. It's called Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I'm weak and worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on. Take my hand, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day at the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home, precious Lord. Take my hand, lead me on, let me stand, 'cause I'm tired, I am weak and worn. Through the storm and through the night, lead me on to the light and take my hand. Precious Lord, lead and lead, yeah, lead me home, lead me home.
Thank you, folks, for coming to the 36th annual Elvis is Back in the Building Birthday Bash. There's a number of people that I'd like to thank, but I'll keep this short and I'll just let a scroll go over my face. First of all, to James Inveld for starting this whole thing back in 1986. To Art Fine for hosting this event so spectacularly for more than three decades. And to Ronnie Mack for being the soul of the establishment. I would like you to follow and like Elvis is Back in the Building Birthday Bash on Facebook so that you can find out more about our artists and whet your appetite for the return to live action in 2023, crossing my fingers. And if you'd like to see some of our artists in a monthly show, come and visit me at the Verdugo Hoot every month up in La Crescenta. Or, you know, you could pick up my book, Limericks of Loss and Regret, and you can be outraged that there's not a single reference to Elvis Presley in it, but one each to Bob Seger, The Captain and Tennille, and System of a Down. Now listen, this is very important. A lot of people disagree about wearing masks and getting boosts, and they're just sick of staying inside and they want to go to their live events. And I hear you, we were all heartbroken that we had to cancel the live event tonight. But we wanna see you healthy and safe next year. So take really good care of yourselves and the people you love, and we'll see you around.
Can't you see I love you? Please don't break my heart in two. That's not hard to do, 'cause I don't have a wooden heart. And if you say goodbye, then I know that I would cry. Maybe I would die, 'cause I don't have a wooden heart. There's no strings upon this love of mine. It was always you from the start.